Hello, everyone. It really is a pleasure for us to be together with you this evening. We're not with you in body, but we certainly are with you in spirit. And I'd just like to piggyback on something that the Apostle Paul said to the brethren in the church at Colossae, that's found in Colossians. He said, though in Colossians chapter 2, I believe, and verse 5, so you can check it out there, it says, for though I am away from you in body, even as Pastor Robin and I are away from you in body, it says, yet I am with you in spirit. And this is what he goes on to say, and this is the same for us. We are delighted at the sight of your standing shoulder to shoulder in such orderly array, and the firmness and the solid front and steadfastness of your faith in Christ Jesus, that leaning of your entire human personality on God in absolute trust and confidence in his power, in his wisdom, and in his goodness. And as you have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, walk in union and in conformity to him. And so even as we may be physically far away from you, our hearts really are with you right here, right now, right where you are and right where we are. As you know, there's no distance in prayer, and we've been praying for you, as I am sure that you have been praying for us. The other day in prayer meeting, I heard a word. A word came to me. It was a still, small voice. It was the voice of the Lord, and he spoke one word to me, and it was this. It was harassment. That was the word, harassment. And he had me look it up. I mean, when I heard the word harassment, immediately I knew, look it up. And even as I looked it up, I'm going to tell you what I found. I personally like to use the Collins English Dictionary, and so I went to it there. But even before I tell you what the definition of the word harassment means, I want to share with you the title of this message. The title of this message is Don't Give In. Don't give in. And it's good news. Don't give in. So harassment, as far as the Collins dictionary is concerned, harassment is behavior which is intended to trouble or annoy someone. For example, repeated attacks on them or attempts to cause them problems. I'm going to read that again because I know some of you are saying, oh, wow, yeah, that sounds just like what I'm experiencing. Harassment. Harassment is behavior which is intended to trouble or annoy someone. For example, repeated attacks on them or attempts to cause them problems, attempts to cause them problems. And synonyms for harassment is hassle, trouble, bother, grieve. Those are synonyms for harassment. And what the Lord would have you to know today is don't give in. Don't give in to the harassment. Don't give in to the harassment. Harassment many times can come, sometimes it comes from the decisions that we've made ourselves. You know, we can't blame the enemy for everything. Sometimes harassment comes through decisions, the consequences of decisions that we have made for ourselves. And so harassment can come that way. But in this context, I believe that the Lord is telling us about how to respond concerning harassment from the kingdom of darkness. We are children of God. We belong to him. It says those who believe in John, 1 John 5 and verse 1, it says those who believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God are born of God. Those who believe that Jesus Christ is the Messiah are born of God. And so we are children of God and we belong to him. And we have a common enemy, an adversary. And he seeks to harass us. Why does he seek to harass us? He seeks to harass us. He seeks to trouble us, to annoy us, to deploy repeated attacks against us, to attempt to cause us problems. Why? Why is it? Is it because you're so special? I'm so special? Is it because, you know, that we are superhumans? It is because we believe in Jesus Christ, and because Christ is being formed on the inside of us, he will do everything that in his power to cause us to move from the position that we are actually in. Now, I'm going to say move from the position that we're actually in. He can't actually move us, but he can cause us to think that we're not in the position that we're actually in. And what's the position that we're actually in? We talked about it just a few minutes ago. We are sons and daughters of the Most High God. Jesus is our big brother. And Christ is being formed on the inside of us. And we are covered by the blood of the Lamb. Not only that, my Bible tells me, the word tells me in Ephesians chapter 2. Let's go to Ephesians. Let's go to Ephesians chapter 2 together. I'm going to be looking at it from the Amplified translation. Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2, and it says in verse 1, it says, "And you, me, us, he," who, Jesus, "made alive when we were dead, slain by our own trespasses and sins." Verse 2, "in which at one time you walked habitually." At one time, all of us walked habitually in our trespasses and sins. It was our habit to trespass and to sin. But he goes on to say, continuing in verse 2, "you were," everybody say were. Right. "You were," did you say were? Right. "You were following the course and fashion of this world." You were, everybody say were again. Were means past tense. "You were under the sway of the tendency of this present age. You were following the prince of the power of the air." It goes on to say in the Amplified, it says, "you were obedient to and under the control of the demon spirit that still constantly works in the sons of disobedience, that is the careless, the rebellious, and the unbelieving who go against the purpose of God." Verse 3, "among these, we as well as you," and the Apostle Paul, I love how he identifies with the church at Colossae, and we're identifying with each other here. Among these who? These sons of disobedience. "We as well," all of us, "as you once lived and conducted ourselves in the passions of our flesh, our behavior governed by our corrupt sensual nature." We were obeying the impulses of the flesh and the thoughts of the mind, our cravings dictated by our senses and our dark imaginings. We were, everybody say were again, were is past tense, so it's good news, were, that's was. Now we're something else. But we were, the word is reminding us, we were then by nature children of God's wrath. We were heirs of his indignation like the rest of mankind. Oh, but in verse 4 it says, "but God." Everybody say, "but God." Say it like you mean it. "But God. But God, so rich is he in his mercy, because of and in order to satisfy the great and wonderful and intense love with which he loved us, even when we were dead, slain by our own shortcomings and trespasses, he made us alive together in fellowship and in union with Christ. He gave us the very life of Christ himself." Oh, can you read that with me? If you're not reading it, let's read it aloud together, because I know you're going to see it on the screen. "He gave us the very life of Christ himself, the same new life with which he quickened him. For it is by grace his favor and mercy, which you did not deserve, that you are saved, delivered from judgment, and made partakers of Christ's salvation. And we read all that. That's all good news, fantastic news. We read all that to get to this point, into verse 6. Because remember, if you remember, we're talking about the position. What position are we in? What position are we in? And what is the aim of the enemy's harassment of us in order for us to not believe the position we're in and to believe that we're in a lower position? This is it. This is the position we are in, purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Verse 6, and he raised us up. Everybody say raised. Raised, past tense. He raised us up together with him and made us sit down together, giving us joint seating with him, with whom? With Jesus, in the heavenly sphere by virtue of our being in Christ Jesus, the Messiah, the Anointed One. And so God, the Father, raised us up, those who have received Jesus as their Savior and Lord. He has raised us up together with him. That's such good news. And made us sit down together, giving us joint seating with him in the heavenly sphere by virtue of our being in Christ Jesus, the Messiah, the Anointed One. This is the position that we're in by the grace of God and by our faith in what God has done through his Son, Jesus Christ. Oh, and let's go to verse 7. He did this. So why did God do this? Many people think, well, what's the significance? Why did God do this? Why did God send his Son to save me? Yes, I've heard it many, many times. I've been going to church since I was a little baby. And every time I go to church, I hear what God did, what the Father did. He sent his Son that those who would believe in him would not perish but have everlasting life. So what is the significance? I don't know why he would do that. In verse 7, it says, he, the Father, did this that he might clearly demonstrate through the ages to come the immeasurable, limitless, surpassing riches of his free grace, his unmerited favor, in his kindness and goodness of heart toward us in Christ Jesus. God is demonstrating to principalities and powers, to every age, for this age and all the ages to come, how rich is his grace and his kindness and his goodness of heart toward us in Christ Jesus. We're on display. Look at your neighbor and say, we're on display. Look at your neighbor and say, I'm a demonstration of God's grace. Amen and amen and amen. And if the enemy, and this message isn't about the enemy, this message is about don't give in. But if the enemy can get us to forget who we are, to forget what Jesus accomplished for us, to forget that we have been raised with him to sit down together with him in the heavenly sphere, to forget that we're on display, then he's got us to shift our position, even if it's in our heart and in our mind. And he brings things to us for us to get harassed. Anybody in the congregation, you're feeling harassed. You can put your hand up if you would like to, but you don't have to put your hand up if you don't want to, but just acknowledge it in your heart. Yeah, yeah. You know what? I'm harassed. I'm feeling harassed. Earlier on today, in fact, more than that, since about yesterday sometime, I have been trying to carve out some time to sit quietly, trying to carve out some time to sit quietly, to gather myself, gather my thoughts, gather, sister, say, okay, Michelle, this is you, it's okay, everything's all right. And every time I have tried to sit quietly, every time, I'm not exaggerating, every time I've tried to sit quietly, to think, to write, to put things together, something, a phone call, sorry, wrong number, somebody calling me for something that I cannot help them with, somebody at the door, all kinds of things. And I was actually becoming harassed. Actually, to be truthful, I think I became harassed. I felt harassed, and I became harassed. And you know when you're harassed, you know what you do? You furrow your forehead like that, and you walk around like this, and people ask you something, and you just answer them short. And you know, and you kind of hunch over because you're harassed. In fact, you know what? I think sometimes we hunch over because we're kind of like a shield, like, okay, if I'm hunched over, then nobody's going to approach me. They're not going to ask me nothing because they can see, you know, don't go there. She doesn't want to talk or he doesn't want to talk. When I realized that I was harassed, and I feel that that's why the Lord spoke to me, that word harassment. 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 Let's go to Acts chapter 10. Acts chapter 10. And verse 38, I've got some good news for you, and it was excellent news for me. Acts chapter 10 and verse 38. This was one of Pastor Sammy's favorite scriptures. Acts chapter 10 and verse 38 in the Amplified Classic, it says this. It says, how God anointed and consecrated Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with strength and ability and power. Again, I'm reading from the Amplified Classic. How he, that's Jesus, went about doing good and in particular, I love that, in particular, curing all who were, yeah, there's the word, all who were harassed and oppressed by the power of the devil, for God was with him. God anointed Jesus and he gave him the strength and the ability and the power, and he went about doing good and curing all who were harassed and oppressed by the power of the devil, for God was with him. There is release from harassment. There is deliverance from harassment. And you know what? It doesn't mean that things aren't going to come. It doesn't mean that the phone's not going to ring or somebody's going to come and ask you to do something when in fact you're trying to get something else done. It doesn't mean all of that. It doesn't mean that there's going to be a shield. Do you remember that movie, Get Smart, when there was when they wanted to have a discussion, and then this kind of plexiglass cone would descend from the ceiling over there, and they would say, this is the cone of silence. How many of you wish you had a cone of silence right now? You had a cone of silence so that when you leave the service and you go out and you go about your day, there's a cone of silence. So you're in the cone getting everything done that you need to get done, and nobody can come and bother you. No, cone of silence. Jesus releasing us and curing all who are harassed and oppressed by the power of the devil doesn't mean that you get a cone of silence around you. You know what it means? It means that regardless of the interruptions, as we call them, and some things we may deem them as interruptions, but they're actually things that we need to do. But yes, even though he has released us, there's a way to walk through the harassment. There's a way to walk through the harassment and kick the devil in the teeth and show him, I am not going to be toppled from my position. In Colossians, I love Colossians 3, it says, I'm going to go there now, Colossians 3. Let's go to Colossians 3. I'm going to go there. Colossians chapter 3. Are you there yet? Colossians 3. I love this. Colossians 3 and verse 1. It says, if then you have been raised with Christ. Remember, if then you've been raised with Christ. Remember, we talked in Ephesians 2 about we were, at one time, we were walking according to the way that the sons of disobedience walked. We were, but now we're not, because we've been raised. Remember, we read it in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 6. He raised us up with Christ. And so it says in Colossians 3 and verse 1, if then you have been raised with Christ to a new life, Thus sharing his resurrection from the dead. Oh, I could preach that for about 3 hours. Thus sharing his resurrection from the dead. If you've been raised with Christ, you share his resurrection from the dead. So if then you have been raised with Christ to a new life, thus sharing his resurrection from the dead, this is the instruction we get. Aim at and seek the rich eternal treasures that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Verse 2, and set your minds and keep them set on what is above, the higher things, not on the things that are on the earth. We'll go on to verse 3. For as far as this world is concerned, you have died. And your new real life is hidden with Christ in God. What does that mean? My life is now hidden with Christ in God. What does that mean? My life is now hidden with Christ in God. It means that my life is in Christ. My whole life, my whole being, how I carry myself is in Christ. And so I walk about my day, I go about my day in Christ. What does that mean? In fellowship with him, knowing that I am in him and he is in me, knowing that his Holy Spirit is not only in me, but with me. I'm surrounded by the Holy Spirit, and my life on the earth now, I live it in Christ. I live it the way that Jesus lived his life. So when the situations come, the harassments and the phone calls and the annoyment, is that a word? I don't know. But the harassment and the attempts by outside forces to annoy us, we, having the information that we have and having the relationship that we have with Christ, we don't need to get harassed. As soon as we recognize the strategy, we throw that all off. We just deal with every situation that it comes your way, but we deal with it with joy in Christ because we know that we're in him. Did you know Jesus was harassed? He didn't feel harassed. He didn't submit to the harassment, but the enemy tried to harass him. And listen, I guarantee, if the enemy tried to harass him, he tries to harass us too, because we're in Christ. Let's go to Luke. Luke chapter 4. Yeah, let's just go. We can go from verse 1. Yeah, let's go to verse 1. Oh, saints, you know what we're sharing and what we're looking at today and the scriptures we're looking at and the things we're pondering on that the Holy Spirit is working on our hearts with, this is not pie in the sky. I hear some people saying, yeah, but you don't know what I have to go through, and you don't know what my day has been like, or you don't know what my week has been like, or you don't know what my life has been like. You don't know what my past year has been like. You have no idea what the month of January was like, or this first week, first couple of weeks in February. You have no idea what it was like. And so, yes, Michelle, all of this sounds like theory. And sometimes I hear people say that when we share these things and share these depths, well, oh, yeah, but you know, it's theory. It's not theory. This is the life that we've been called to. It's glorious. Now, the enemy tried to harass Jesus. It says in Luke chapter 4 and verse 1, it says, then Jesus, full of and controlled by the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan as and was led in by the Holy Spirit during 40 days in the wilderness, the desert, where he was tempted, tried, tested exceedingly by the devil. And he ate nothing during those days, and when they were completed, he was hungry. Verse 3. Then the devil said to him, oh boy. Then the devil said to him, if you are the Son of God, order this stone to turn into a loaf of bread. If you are the Son of God. And the harassment comes to us, brothers, sisters. The same harassment comes to us because he's testing. Do you know who you are? Do you know who you are? Oh, talking of harassment, I tell you, apart from the last couple of days, which I shared with you about every time I was trying to get quiet, it's like, oh. And not, it wasn't any externally, you know. There were some times where I was able to be quiet, where I was able, but my mind was going. And so it was coming from the inside too. My mind going. I'm trying to be quiet, but my mind keeps. Anyway, but apart from that, my family and I have been subject to quite a lot of harassment of lately. Have you ever been through a situation with, like, within four weeks, coming close to Christmas or around the Christmas season, the freezer breaks down? It gets seen to. 2 weeks later, it breaks down again. After the freezer breaks down, then the pump starts to give, the water pump starts to give some trouble. Then after the water pump starts to give a little trouble, Christmas Eve, the fridge is not working as it should. Then a week or two later, the washing machine stops washing. It's called harassment. But the devil said to him, verse 3, if you are the Son of God, if you are the Son of God. How many know you're going through a difficult situation and circumstance, or many? And it can cause us to try and think, oh, well, maybe God doesn't love me. You know, we always look at other people. You can look at everybody, other people, and say, oh, look how good things are going with them. God must really love them. I don't think he loves me. No. Don't give in to that temptation of the devil to cause you to question who you are. Yes, you are, as long as you've received Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior, you've accepted the sacrifice that he's made on your behalf, you are a son or daughter of God. John chapter, I'm going to turn there quickly and then we're going to come back to Luke 4. John chapter 1. And John chapter 1 and verse 12. Oh, yeah. John chapter 1 and verse 12. This is the book of John. Chapter 1, the Gospel of John. Chapter 1 and verse 12. It says, but to as many as did receive and welcome him, welcome who? Jesus. He gave the authority, the power, and the privilege to become what? The children of God. That is, to those who believe in, who adhere to, trust in, and rely on his name. Look at this in verse 13. Who owe their birth neither to bloods nor to the will of the flesh, that of physical impulse, nor to the will of man, that of a natural father, but to God. They are what? Born of God. Let's go to First John. I mentioned it earlier. Let's go to First John. And I was going to go to verse 3, but I'm going to go to chapter 5. Sorry, I was going to go to chapter 3, but I'm going to chapter 5. So that's 1 John 5 and verse 1. It says, everyone who believes, adheres to, trusts, and relies on the fact. Everybody say the fact. The fact that Jesus is the Christ, the Messiah, is a born again, what? Child of God. And everyone who loves the Father also loves the one born of him, his offspring. And verse 2, by this we come to know, recognize, and understand that we love the children of God when we love God and obey his commands. And obey his commands. 1 John 3 and verse 1 John chapter 3 verse 1 says, see what an incredible quality of love the Father has shown, has bestowed on us, that we should be permitted to be named and called and counted the children of God. And so we are. The reason that the world does not know, recognize, and acknowledge us is that it does not know, recognize, and acknowledge him. Beloved, we are even here and now God's children. Hallelujah. Bless God forever. We are even, beloved, we are even here and now God's children. So don't let the enemy who's bringing the harassment cause you to doubt who you are. We are children of the Most High God. Jesus is our perfect example of how to walk through this life, how to walk through the life on terra firma, on planet Earth, right here, right now. And so the devil comes to Jesus in Luke chapter 4 and verse 3, and he says to him, if you are the Son of God, because remember, Jesus hungry. How many ever questioned your identity in Christ because you're hungry? Anyway, he was hungry. Verse 3 says, then the devil said to him, if you are the Son of God, order this stone to turn into a loaf of bread. That means he's saying, if you are, first of all, you know, I don't know. Do you know? I don't know if you know, but if you are the Son of God, right? So question that. Also, that's what he's trying to say. Also, he's trying to say, prove it. Do something to satisfy your own self. You're hungry? If you Son of God, then look, lots of stones here in the desert. Turn that stone into a loaf of bread. Prove it. Prove it. And he comes to us with the same thing. Whatever it is that you're going through, whatever situations and circumstances you're going through, things that you need, are you going to be motivated by your own hunger, by your own wanting, by your own flesh, and by the enemy instigating your flesh? Or are you going to hearken to the word of the Lord and say, no, God says, this is his promise to me, and I'm going to stand on the word of God. I can try, we can all try, and many of us, I know, including myself, have done this. Try to fix things in our own strength. Try to sort stuff out. Try to finagle, manipulate, control situations so that I can get the outcome I want, so that you can get the outcome you want. Many times we've done it. Many, many times we've done it. Try to control and manipulate and do things, first of all, in our own strength, and second of all, to get the outcome that will satisfy us, the outcome we think will satisfy us. And doing it without the direction of the Lord. And the enemy is trying to get Jesus to do the same thing. If you are the Son of God, order this stone to turn into a loaf of bread. After all, you are hungry. And what does Jesus reply to him? And what's our reply to the enemy? And Jesus replied to him, it is written. When the enemy comes to you with that kind of question, find out what the word says. Jesus says, it is written, man shall not live and be sustained by or on bread alone, but by every word and expression of God. What is the promise of God to you? What has God told you? What is the direction? What is the instruction of the word to you in the situations that you're facing, even in the harassments, the discomfort? Jesus wasn't comfortable at this time. He wasn't comfortable. He was uncomfortable. He was hungry. He'd already been through 40 days and nights of fasting, and he was still in the wilderness, in the desert. And if he had turned this stone into bread, he would have brought himself comfort. But he said, No. Man shall not live and be sustained by or on bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. I'm saying, go with the word. Stay with the word. Stick with what God has said. Don't try to satisfy yourself. Don't try to work the situation so that it kind of work out the way you think it should work out. Stay with the word. Then the devil took him up to a high mountain, it says in verse 5, and showed him all the kingdoms of the habitable world in a moment of time, in the twinkling of an eye. And he said to him, to you I will give all this power and authority and their glory, all their magnificence, excellence, preeminence, dignity and grace. For it has been turned over to me. And we know that that's the truth. He wasn't lying there. And I give it to whomever I will. And that was that. That's not that. That is the truth. He wasn't lying there for once. And therefore, he says, Therefore, if you will do homage to and worship me just once, it shall all be yours. And Jesus replied to him, get behind me, Satan. And Jesus replied to him, get behind me, Satan. It is written, you shall do homage to and worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve. Then in verse 9, he says, then he took him. Now the harassment wasn't finished. We think it's one thing and then it's over. Oh yes, I stood on the word with that. So, you know, I'm going to get a little breeze out now, you know. No. It's not like that. Stay with the word. Stay with what God has said. Stay with what God has said. Stay with the word. No matter how many times the harassment, the difficulty and the stress comes, stay with the word and be cool and calm. I believe, the word doesn't say here. It doesn't say in the word how Jesus was. But I think Jesus was calm and collected. I don't think he was like, oh, would you just leave me alone? Would you just leave me alone? Notice that Jesus, this is just interesting now. Notice Jesus didn't say, get out, Satan, go, leave me. He didn't even say that. He said, get behind me, Satan. It is written, you shall do homage to and worship the Lord your God, and him only shall you serve. I.e., I ain't going to do what you're telling me to do. And then he took him to Jerusalem, and he set him on a gable of the temple and said to him again, if you are the Son of God, you see the harassment? Do you see her harassment? And Jesus didn't turn and tell him, how many times I told you? How many times I have to tell you? He says in verse 9, if you are the Son of God, the devil says, cast yourself down from here, for it is written, he will give his angels charge over you to guard and watch over you closely and carefully. And on their hands, they will bear you up, lest you strike your foot against a stone. And Jesus replied to him, the scripture says, you shall not test exceedingly the Lord your God. When you're going through times of harassment and distress, don't do something unwise. Don't do something foolish. Don't go and do something that, you know, well, God, you said whatever, so I'm just going to prove you. Don't test God. Really, don't test God. It's not a good idea. Jesus says, you shall not test exceedingly the Lord your God. Don't tempt God. When you're going through times of harassment, don't try to get as close to the edge of what God, you know in your heart, You know in your heart how you're supposed to conduct yourself going through life in general, whether it's difficult or whether it's easy, whether life is easy at the moment or difficult. You know in your heart how we're supposed to walk through life. Don't, when you're going through harassment, don't try to get to the edge of what is permissible to God. You understand what I'm trying to say? And make unwise or foolish decisions. Don't tempt God. Stay within the direction of the word, what the word says. And verse 13 it says, and when the devil, I love this, and when the devil had ended the complete cycle of temptation, he temporarily left him, that is, stood off from him, until another more opportune and favorable time. But when we switch over to the Passion Translation of same Luke chapter 4, verse 13, it says, that finished the devil's harassment. Let's go back to verse 12. Jesus replied, it is also written in the scriptures, how dare you provoke the Lord your God? And verse 13, that finished the devil's harassment for the time being. That finished the devil's harassment for the time being. So he stood off at a distance, retreating, or listen to this, until the time came to return and tempt Jesus again. So he, the devil, stood off at a distance, retreating until the time came to return and tempt Jesus again. Why are you laughing, Michelle? Because I'm laughing because it's funny. It's hysterical. You have to laugh the laugh of faith. You know, when we look through situations and circumstances, and instead of being like, oh, no, I thought one way, you know, once I won that battle, there's not going to be any more, you know, and you know, you just have to win one battle and then, you know, you're set for life. Oh, where has that ever been true? It certainly wasn't true for Jesus. And so we have to laugh the laugh of faith. Why can we laugh the laugh of faith? That even though trouble comes and even though difficulties come, and maybe you're going through difficulties on the job, maybe they're not doing you right on job, you know? Maybe there's stuff happening and you know it's wrong and that they're not treating you right and whatever and the whole thing on your job or in your family or situations, you know, as they come from all different sides. We laugh the laugh of faith because Christ in me is the hope of glory. I'm on display. I am salt and light. I'm present in this situation to bring salt, to bring light, to bring life. In Isaiah chapter 60, it says, arise and shine, for thy light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. Let's go there together. Let's go there together, even as we close. Isaiah chapter 60. Arise, it says, in the Amplified it says, arise from the depression and prostration in which circumstances have kept you. It didn't say, now that the circumstances have been resolved, now that everything's cool and peaceful, now that everything's sorted out, all the ducks are in a row, now arise and shine. No, it says, arise from, and that's my word. That's my word and Pastor Robin's word to you in the river, right there, right here, right now, today. Arise from the depression. Arise from the prostration in which circumstances have kept you. Don't give in. Don't give in to the harassment of the enemy. Show him, demonstrate to him, display to him that Christ in me is the hope of glory. Greater is he that is in me than you that's in the world. I'm walking through this thing victoriously. I'm walking through this thing with glory in me and on me because I can't go wrong because I'm standing on the Word, and the Word was made flesh, and His name is Jesus, and there's nothing that can separate me from the love of God. So even though I'm trying to be quiet and the phone calls come and it's the wrong number and I'm trying to get this or that done, and I keep getting interrupted, or the fridge goes bad, the TV, whatever it is that goes bad, and it seems like it's one thing after the next, 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 I hold my head up high, I laugh the laugh of faith. What is the laugh of faith? The laugh of faith is you laugh and know you won't feel like it. You just say, ha 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 ha. You laugh as though you don't, even though you don't feel like it. That's the laugh of faith, because the Word says, arise from the depression and prostration in which circumstances have kept you. We acknowledge that there's circumstances that have kept us, that have made us depressed, that have made us prostrated. But the Word to you today, ITR, is arise and shine. Rise to a new life. What's a new life? It's not the old life. Many people, you know, we think, well, arise to a new life, that it's just something that's, you know, in theory. It's in theory, but it's the truth. It's the fact. Jesus has come. He's already come. He came so that we would shine. He came so that we would shine through in the earth, even though there's darkness around us. And I'm coming to that. Rise to a new life. A new life is not the old life. A new life means, it doesn't mean that everything's sorted out and perfect. It means it's a new way of living, a new way of being, a new way of walking through this life. Rise to a new life. Shine. Shine. Even though there's harassment, shine. Shine. Be radiant. With what? The glory of the Lord. For your light has come. Jesus has already come. And the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. Verse 2, even as we close. For behold, darkness shall cover the earth. It's a fact. You can see it. You can see it. For behold, darkness shall cover the earth, and dense darkness all peoples. But the Lord shall arise upon you, and His glory shall be seen on you. That's the reason. That's the reason. With trouble on the job, trouble in the family, whatever it is you're going through, we have been created, recreated to shine. Even though there's darkness going on all around us, we've been created to bring the light. Amen. Because His glory shall be seen on you. You know, if we give in to the harassment, and if we give in to those situations and circumstances, then we cover the light with a bushel. We allow the darkness to cover the light. But that's impossible. His glory shall be seen on you. Shine. And nations, people shall come to your light. People will say, boy, but you're going through, I know what you're going through, and how come you're living life like this? Nations shall come to your light. And kings to the brightness of your rising. Kings, people in authority, people who have power, people who are in rulership, shall come to the brightness of your rising. Lift up your eyes, ITR. Lift up your eyes, ITR. Lift up your eyes, ITR, round about you, and see. They all gather themselves together. They come to you. Your sons shall come from afar, and your daughters shall be carried and nursed in the arms. Then you shall see and be radiant, and your heart shall thrill and tremble with joy at the glorious deliverance, and be enlarged. And so our word to you, beloved of ITR, beloved people of ITR, our word to you is arise, shine, for your light has come. Don't give in. Jesus has already come. The glory of the Lord has already risen upon you, and the glory of the Lord will shine through you. Amen and amen. Let's pray. If you would stand to your feet. Everybody stand to your feet. Let's pray. Let's pray. Father, you're so good to us. Father, I pray for my brothers and sisters. I pray for the house of ITR. I pray that we would have a new revelation, a fresh revelation, a deeper revelation of what you have accomplished for us through your Son, Jesus Christ, that we would live in the fullness day by day, increasingly, progressively increasing in the fullness of the power of the resurrected Christ, that we would understand and know and live it and grasp it, that we would grasp it, that we've been born again to shine. We've been born again to bring light into dark places. And it's not a theory, but it is a practice. It's our lives. And so even now, Father, we lift up the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. How majestic is your name in all the earth. Thank you that we are yours and you are ours. I call the people of the house blessed and full of the light of God to shine. Even as they leave this place, to shine. Let our focus be to shine. We've been born again to shine. In Jesus' name, amen and amen and amen.